Hi, thank you so much. Welcome to today's Council on Foreign Relations discussion of the documentary A la Calle. I'm Marcia Biggs. I'm special correspondent for PBS NewsHour, and I'll be presiding over today's discussion. We have an incredible panel. We have Leopoldo Lopez, member of the Venezuelan interim government, the national coordinator and founder of Voluntad Popular. We have Rebecca Bill Chavez, the non-resident senior fellow for the Inter-American Dialogue. And we have the co-director and producers, co-directors slash producers, this amazing film, A la Calle, Nelson Gonzalez Navarrete and Max Caicedo. So on a personal note, having spent several weeks reporting in Venezuela at the beginning of this year and continuing to report throughout COVID, it's an honor for me to be moderating this panel and the screening of this really, really beautiful film and timely film. We've got a lot to get to though in half an hour, or actually in 1 hour, but I only have half an hour. So Leopoldo Lopez, let's start with you. The film, you're a major character in this film, and it really marks your journey throughout the last, really since 2014. In 2014, you turned yourself in under what are widely believed to be trumped up charges. You spent almost 7 years in prison under house arrest until about a month ago when you escaped the country to Spain, where you're now in exile and joining us. There's an incredible scene in the film of you climbing up onto a statue to address thousands back in 2014, right before you took yourself in, where you shout, "I will never leave Venezuela. I will never leave Venezuela." Tell me about having to make that decision.
Well, you're a great journalist. You know how to get straight to very key points. And that for me is, it's a very significant decision. I've made several significant decisions, like turning myself in voluntarily because I was not arrested. And I had 7 years ago, three options: to remain undercover, to go into exile, or to present myself to an unjust justice and certainly go for years of prison. I knew that that was the consequence of turning myself in voluntarily 7 years ago. And I knew at the time that that could contribute, as in fact it did, to raise awareness in Venezuela and outside Venezuela about what was happening. In 2013, we had a discussion, a political discussion. What is happening in Venezuela? How? Where do we stand with this simple question? Is this a democracy or is this a dictatorship? And that was a simple question. Took a debate and we concluded that it was a dictatorship. So we decided to do something about it. And we said, we need to go to la calle, a la calle, con la gente, with the people. We need to raise awareness, channel the frustration and promote through street protest, the possibility of political change in Venezuela. And the situation led me to jail. And 7 years after that, after having spent 4 years in a military prison, then in house arrest, then in asylum in the Spanish embassy, I concluded that at this point, I could contribute to the fight for freedom in Venezuela, which unfortunately we have not reached freedom in Venezuela from exile. And it was a difficult decision, but I am sure that we will go back, and I can tell you that I spent my entire day with my heart and my mind in Venezuela. I know I'm physically here, but I continue to be focused in doing whatever it takes to mobilize, to organize, and to keep the awareness active in Venezuela and now outside Venezuela, where we have 6 million people were forced, as I was, to leave our country, because nobody leaves their country voluntarily. So we were forced, 6 million Venezuelans, to leave our country. And that's a reality, the circumstance in which we have to fight now.
What can you tell us about how you escaped? It seems impossible to do without at least the tacit approval of someone with inside the regime.
No, there wasn't. Something that prisoners do all the time, and you can ask anybody that has been in jail, is to think about how you could escape, and especially if you're a political prisoner. So this is something that one dedicates time to. While I was in prison, I thought about that, of course. And then being at the embassy, I knew that at some point this decision was going to happen. So I spent a lot of time thinking about how to put this together. And a month before I finally escaped, I decided to start the planning. So the first thing was to leave the embassy, because the embassy was surrounded by the police of the dictatorship, more than 25 members of the police. And it was also surrounded by cameras and by Spanish police. So I had to plan where were the blind spots and where what was the timing in which the political police was making their shifts and that they were with less attention. So I spent a month overseeing all, everything that was happening. So that was the first step. And then after leaving the embassy, I organized with a very small group of people a process of leaving the country. We selected a day that was a day of flexibility because of COVID. That was the first day in like 2 months time or a month and a half that was total flexibility. So we knew that that was going to be a day with a lot of traffic in comparison to prior days. So we decided to put ourselves in a covert with a makeshift, well, to be, I don't know how to say this, disfrazados.
dress alike?
Yeah, well,
like,
cover.
Like, so, guys, yeah.
So, so that's how we were able to go through almost 20 alcabalas, 20 police or military points. At the end, the last one, it was difficult. I can tell you that that we have a very, very, very rough time at the very end, just right where the border was. At some someday, I can I'm gonna call Max and Nelson and tell them we're gonna do the second part of the of the documentary and give them details of everything that happened. But it was something that we planned. A very small group of people, as I said before. I have pictures and I have some video of how we did it. So it was on our own. We took a lot of risks, but fortunately we made it through.
So what happens next, especially vis-a-vis Juan Guaido? You were a mentor of his and he took the mantle when you were silenced. You talk about that in the film. What happens to him now that you're free to speak?
Well, we are a team, and he's leading this process. He's the president in charge with a very concrete mandate to bring free and fair elections to Venezuela. And I think we always need to remember that. What we need in Venezuela is free and fair elections in order for the Venezuelan people to decide our future. And Venezuela requires a great level of popular legitimacy for the recovery of our country. And that can only happen through free and fair elections that are verifiable and supported by the international community. So that's a mandate that Juan Guaido has, that we have, that the National Assembly has. And I'm part of that team. Of course, I work very closely with him. I respect everything that he has been doing. It has not been easy. There were very high expectations in 2019. And I know, and this is something that I spoke with Guaido on January the 1st of last year. He was sworn in as president in charge January the 5th. So by in January the 1st, I was already speaking with the police that was doing the surveillance of my house. So I asked them to give me the possibility of bringing some cousins for the 1st of January celebration where we eat lentils. It's a tradition that we have. So he was able to come in with a hat. They didn't know who he was. So we had a conversation. And it was very important because it was the only presence conversation that we had before and since then. Everything happened last year. So I told him, listen, the first days are going to be easy. You're going to have great popularity. I didn't know it was going to be as important and as massive as it was, But then we're going to go down. And that's just the way it goes. And that's, we need to be prepared for that, because that's when we need to lead. We are going to be in a good circumstance, and that's going to be the easy part. The phone is going to ring. People are going to be supporting. Things are going to look very good. Everybody is going to be your friend. And then there's going to come the time when the cycle changes and we're going to be in a difficult situation. And I am absolutely, absolutely convinced that that's when you meet the real requirement of leadership. When things are going in a difficult way, when you need to lead, when you need to open roads, when you need to light the candle where there is darkness. And that's the situation that we've been having. We've been atop, and now we need to build a new cycle. And I think this movie, and I think this documentary, which was excellently thought about, and everything that they went through, now we are going to hear everything that they did in order to have all this footage. But I think it taps into a sentiment of going to the streets to protest. And I absolutely support that. And I'm all for the protests, for peaceful protests, for nonviolence, for doing what Martin Luther King said in the Letters of Birmingham, when he says nonviolence is about showing the wounds and making what's ugly about a society open to the rest of society so something can happen. And that's what nonviolence is. And that's what we did in 2014. And that's what happened in 2017. And that's what all happened again in 2019 when Guaido came out. So I think that we need to build another cycle. I know that there's a lot of pessimism, but we've been there before. We've been there in very pessimistic years. And I know situation is even worse than it was before, but we have a clear purpose, which is to mobilize people, consciousness, countries, parliaments, governments, everything that we need to move in order to free our country. Because Venezuela today, as it's very well depicted in the documentary, is going through a very difficult situation. Hunger, at the exile of 6 million people, and the situation that has been brought to tragedy to millions of people because of a dictator. So we need to do whatever it takes. We need to go as far as we need to go in order to mobilize again the Venezuelan society. So I think this is a very timely documentary that is coming out, because it will remind us about different things, about how important the streets are, about the force that we have. We cannot overestimate ourselves, but we cannot underestimate the capacity of the society to mobilize and to show face to the dictatorship. And it also shows that we need to be prepared, organized, and that this cycle can happen again, and that we need to push for it. We need to build it. And I know it's difficult, but that's the circumstance that we need to face now.
I have so many more questions for you, but I do want to move on to another question that is really more directed to Rebecca. The Trump administration took a hard line against Maduro, the Maduro regime. And there were many that I was speaking to in Venezuela when I was there 10 months ago, and then throughout the election this year, who believed that they were hoping for a Trump victory. And they believed that at his hands, there could be a more forceful intervention. So where does the Biden administration want to take the US-Venezuela relations and this fight? Is there a desire to help in this fight? Oh, you need to unmute yourself.
Sorry about that. I first want to say what an honor it is to be here with Leopoldo Lopez, whose courage and sacrifice, like you said, Marcia, has served as an inspiration to so many. And also with Max and Nelson, because this film, I think it sheds light, and it really importantly draws attention to and raises awareness about the magnitude of the humanitarian crisis and the erosion of democracy in Venezuela, which doesn't get near enough attention in the media here. And I've told them before that their storytelling is so powerful that even though I knew the tragic outcome at various junctures in the film, these moments of hope, my heart broke all over again during the film. So Yeah, that's an excellent question. And I do, I'm in a sense, I'm not surprised at the reactions you heard in Venezuela to about Trump in particular, because, you know, he did, there was a lot of tough talk coming out of Trump, and, you know, there was the saber rattling. But really, from my perspective, that was really all about electoral politics in Florida, because everything he did, none of it brought about successful change. And in fact, I think you can say that the suffering of the Venezuelan people increased. For Biden and Harris, Venezuela will be a priority. And both the President-elect Biden and Vice President-elect Harris have been really clear that Maduro is at the center of the man-made disaster in Venezuela. They call Maduro what he is, a dictator responsible for the suffering of the Venezuelan people. I think what they'll do, though, is they will, I think that they reject Trump's unilateral go-it-alone policy, and they're also going to cease the saber rattling, because that's pushed away the very partners needed to support democratic progress. President-elect Biden is going to work with our regional and with our international partners to facilitate a political transition. And that's groups like the Lima Group, the OAS, the International Contact Group. The Biden and Harris are also going to work with our partners to provide humanitarian assistance, which is more critical than ever with the COVID-19 crisis. And as the film points out, this is a country that faces an 85% shortage of basic medicines. And Marcia, that's something you do so well when you talk in your reporting on Venezuela about the hunger and the state of the healthcare system. And they're also going to work with, Biden and Harris are also going to work with partners to protect the over 4 million Venezuelan refugees, like Randall Blanco, who was showcased in the film. Because this exodus, which is on track to surpass Syria, has overwhelmed regional governments that are struggling to address this huge influx of just desperate refugees. And the final thing I'll say about the new administration is that during the primaries, both Biden and Harris were clear in their commitment that they are going to grant temporary protected status to the Venezuelans that are living in the United States, something Trump has refused to do despite his claims to really care about the Venezuelan people.
But you have to get that through the Senate.
Yes. Well, first of all, hopefully January 5th, we'll see a good outcome. But I think that there's through executive action and other ways, this is a priority. And although the world, there are many other priorities when we look at the globe, Venezuela is going to be is up there on the list.
So I want to, you mentioned the humanitarian crisis, and I want to kind of pivot back to the film. The film is so beautiful, Max and Nelson, and it weaves together really these poignant stories of everyday people with incredible footage of what was happening in the streets and what was happening with you, Leopoldo. One thing that was just so strong throughout the entire film is hunger. So I want to talk a little bit about what, you know, how you made this film and what it was that drew you to this film. What were you hoping to achieve? Max, I'll start with you.
Hey, thank you. I definitely really appreciate the opportunity to be on a panel with Rebecca and Leo. Leo and I have been talking a long time about this issue. Nelson and I are always talking about this, but to have an audience like this is really a great opportunity. And I think the first thing to answer a question that we wanted to do with our film was to focus the conversation around the things that were actually happening and that were important. I think oftentimes when you look at what's going on in Venezuela, you have conversations, lots of conversations about the Venezuelan crisis, but they often get put in terms of socialism versus capitalism, the left versus the right, American foreign policy and intervention versus, you know, Latin American autonomy and self-determination. And all of these conversations are fine and they're academic and they're great, but they really steer away from the actual conversation I think that Nelson, I think, is the most important, which is a stifling of a democratic country and their ability to vote their own leaders and determine their own way in an open, free way, but also the humanitarian crisis, which is overwhelming not just Venezuelans, but all the countries nearby. So I think for Nelson and I, when we saw the opportunity or when we were approached to create this film, we said to ourselves, okay, what are the key issues in Venezuela that we want to highlight? What's the conversation we want to have and that we think other people should be having? And then focus in on those things. Hunger, medical issues, humanitarian crisis, democracy, all these things were sort of the big topics that we wanted to focus on, which is why you see those things take prominence in our film.
But I also thought it was so interesting the way you made the parallels with other nations and other leaders. You really kind of, you stepped back and really looked at, you know, how it plays out all over the world. Nelson, maybe you can talk a little bit about that, the sort of playbook for dismantling democracy that you get into.
Wow. Yeah, first of all, thanks for having us here. And glad to see you again, Leo, in other circumstances. I think our film started structuring itself as we started capturing the stories. I think Max mentioned most of the pillars that were important to us. And then we center around something very important, which was the economy. I think the economy was something really difficult to explain. Even for us, was difficult to understand because the devaluation of the Bolivar was happening overnight. Now the problem is not even the same as in the film. You know, before you couldn't find cash, now is, you know, dollars that are running the street. So we try to capture as much as we could within the means that we had at the moment. So understanding the economic, understanding the humanitarian crisis, understanding maybe the crimes against humanity that were happening in the country, we tried to position characters that could tell the stories in a relatable way. And because we knew that many people weren't going to be able to feel the pressure that we're going through, because not everybody has to leave their country in a hurry. Not everybody could go to political prison for protesting. You know, here in the United States, we have the ability to express what we want, what we need, you know, to change. In Venezuela, we actually don't, you know. And through our characters, we found a very relatable bridge. And then so we wanted to paint this picture that everybody could go through this problem, like a Randall with his daughter, and suffer to not be able to feed his daughter. So, you know, we work as a bridge to tell the stories of these characters and paint the overall picture for people to see it in a, like in an hour and a half, you know, and be able to digest it and eventually understand that the situation is actually global, you know, that these problems could happen to any of us. You know, right now we could be in a democracy, but as you take the freedom of vote, as you take the freedom of speech, and as you take all these important parts of a society to function in a democratic way, then overnight you could be found in 2014. And then, you know, the students go to the street and then Leopoldo's in the street and everybody's demanding change, but it's too late, you know? So when it's too late, it's kind of like a feeling that you have to have as a citizen and be able to like see it before it comes, you know? And as Venezuelans, I feel like we've gone through that experience and we're able to tell that story.
And you had quite a difficult time getting footage out, I understand.
Yeah, it was very difficult. Venezuela's internet, just to put into perspective, to get a gigabyte of information takes almost like 3 days, you know? So it was impossible to send information by internet. And then the airports are also very restricted, you know, as far as like moving equipment. So we had to move hard drives in and out of the country as family, friends were traveling, and we tried to do it with people that had nothing to do with the documentary. So it was very easy to just make it like a simple meetup, you know, like a family thing. So yeah, it was very, very difficult. It's actually one of the hardest things because we would see the footage 4 months, 5 months later. And then, we had to recreate the story in a hurry. So it was very challenging.
I just wanted to jump in there to add to the point previous about the sort of larger story that we're telling in, or the global implications in that moment that we tried to discuss. I think one thing that Nelson and Leopoldo and anyone who from Venezuela will say is that, you know, you're living in a democracy, you're living in a strong democracy. And when things start to go a little awry or things start to, like, you know, indicators that things are just not quite as free and open, your immediate inclination is not to say we're in a dictatorship, because there's a lot of things that make you not want to say that. One, you don't want that to be the case. And so you're going to say everything to yourself to say, no, this is not the case. But also a lot of people, and I think Venezuela fell into this position, that they'd say, no, this can't happen to us. We've had a democracy for so long. It's been so strong. It's not us. You know what I mean? And it takes a lot of confidence, courage, and it's risky to stick your neck out there and say, no, this is a dictatorship, and to start saying those types of things, because that is a very bold statement, and that's not always received very well internationally at all. So I think for us, it's to say, to show though that moment, or our attempt to make it more global, was also to say to a lot of countries, even in America, who might take for granted the strength of their own democratic institutions, that no, this thing can happen, and it's going to be subtle, and you may not recognize it, because these things happen in a very piecemeal process over the course of years. So I think that was like another aspect of why we felt that it was important to make that statement a little bit larger.
Marcia, I just want to add one quick thing to this that we talked about in the past, and that is that the Venezuela case is it really, it's a classic case that shows that democracy just isn't just about elections, although we know elections in Venezuela are no longer free and fair, but it's about institutions and the rule of law. And by bringing in this comparative perspective and kind of putting it in terms of the global democratic recession, and you know, showing how Maduro has taken steps out of the same authoritarian playbook that's been used by people like Putin, Duterte, Assad, Hernandez, that, and I think again, like that I really appreciate that the film did that. It served as such an important reminder of the importance of institutions. Like, what happens when you eliminate the independence of the courts? Well, it paves the way for a president like Chavez at the time to rewrite the constitution so he gets indefinite reelection. You know, seizing the control of the media is another step. You know, and ultimately, as the story of with the National Assembly, you know, after the opposition for the first time since 1999, you know, got actually 2/3 majority in the National Assembly. What did Maduro do? He created the Constituent Assembly to really overshadow the last democratic institution that was standing at the time, you know, allowing him to rule by decree.
Well, speaking of, I just want one more question before I'll open it up. But Leopoldo, speaking of the National Assembly, the elections are next week. And really, you've been operating with dueling parliaments since January of this year. And the opposition has said that it will boycott these elections. So will you just continue to have dueling parliaments, or what is the plan?
Well, unfortunately, this is not the first time. It's actually the third time in 3 years. Oh. That we're going to have a fraudulent election. The first one was in, not the first one, but the latest one was in 2017 for the election of that National Constituent Assembly, which was simply a shadow assembly, completely fraudulent, to try to displace the legitimacy of the National Assembly that was elected in 2015 with 14 million votes and got 2/3 of the seats were of the democratic sector. Then in 2018, Maduro presents himself again in a fraudulent election, and that was not recognized by more than 60 countries in the world. And that led to the recognition in January of Juan Guaido as the interim president, precisely because the Maduro elections the year before were fraudulent. So now we have this attempt of Maduro to again substitute the legitimacy of the National Assembly by doing a fraudulent process, which is not going to be recognized by the United States or by Europe or by the region. So it's going to have the same consequence as the other processes. But what we need at this moment is to continue to fight. And we need to continue to have the support, the united support from Venezuelans and from our international coalition to the National Constituent Assembly and to Juan Guaido as the legitimate representatives of the democratic sector in Venezuela. Because one of the risks that we are facing is that the opposition movement or the democratic movement, those who are willing to fight, to organize, to promote and to create this new cycle that I am sure we need of mobilization in the streets and by other means, could be dismantled. So it's very important to have that recognition of the leadership that is undergoing tremendous pressures. I have friends who, many of them have been imprisoned as I was. They have been tortured, physically tortured, as is displayed in the film, and doing politics in Venezuela, being voiceful and upfront against the dictatorship has consequences. It can take you to jail, or it can take your life. My friend, Pipo Rada, who is also depicted in the film, he was with me the day I presented myself to the unjust system. He was kidnapped in the year 2018. Then he was tortured. He received two gunshots in his head. And then his body was taken outside the place where he was murdered. And he was, they throw gasoline in his body. They put a wet mantle in his face so we could recognize or who he was, his identity, and they burnt him. And they did all that as a message because he was being a very strong leader in Petare. Nelson knows Petare, that is a popular sector in Caracas. And this is just one example. I can name many others, and many other people are not being even named and don't even have the possibility of having their cases being presented. And all that situation has led to the UN to declare Venezuela and Maduro particularly as responsible for committing crimes against humanity and violations, severe violations of human rights. So that's what Maduro is. And we need all the support not to legitimize Maduro and to isolate Maduro and to promote free and fair elections. And we are facing a very difficult international moment, a world moment that has the attention of countries inward. But this is, as I think Max said, this is not about left or right. This is not about conservatives or liberals. This is not about Democrats or Republicans. This is about freedom. And Venezuela might be one of the very few cases in the world where we are at the essence of a fight for freedom. And we need the support of the free world. We need the committed support of the free world not to let Venezuelans die out in our fight to achieve free and fair elections and freedom. And yes, it's been difficult. And once you see the film, I think it was Rebecca that said it, that knowing that what the outcome is going to be of many of what we are looking at, and that the outcome was not good in the sense that we did not reach freedom at the time, we need to continue. And I think if this film contributes to keep the light lit and the hope and the understanding that we need to mobilize, we need to organize, we need to believe that we will reach freedom. So I really want to thank Max and Nelson. They were very patient, and I can tell you that they're very insistent, that they are very committed to what they're doing. And they, as I said, they really didn't know what the outcome was going to be because they were getting so much footage, and the situation was changing so much. I mean, you could have written an end of the documentary in 2018 or a very different ending in 2019. And now there is a different ending in 2019. But at the end, what we want, and I'm sure in the future, this documentary will be complemented at least in lettering saying at year 2021 or very short, the Venezuelans finally reached freedom and they are going to a free and fair election to elect whomever is going to lead them in the future.
Thank you so much. At this time, I'd like to invite the members who've joined us to join our conversation with questions. So Laura, I'm going to pass it to you. And since everyone's going to just jump off this meeting before I get to say goodbye to you, I'd like to thank you for all for joining us. Laura?
We'll take the first question from William Lures. Ambassador Lures, please accept the unmute now prompt.
Yes. Thank you for calling on me. Leopoldo, Bill and Wendy Lures, you have brought such honor to your nation, to your family, whom we've known for three generations, and to all of us who care about what you're bringing about and bringing attention to freedom around the world, even in the United States, where we were worried for a while. I guess I'd have to say that your courage, and both spiritual, mental, and physical, is comparable to what I knew in Mandela and Václav Havel, whom I knew, and you've reminded me of them. I love the film. It brought your story, and as you point out, a midterm story of Venezuela and Leopoldo López. There'll be a second story, and it'll be a better story. I want to ask you one question. The film did not mention the role of Cuba. And would it be counterintuitive to think one solution to this problem would be a coalition of nations who would make it worth Cuba's while to play a constructive role in helping bring a transition from the Maduro government? I know it's been tried a couple of times, and it would be very difficult politically for President Biden, I know, but it seems to me it's one conceivable alternative, as contrarian as it seems.
Should I? Yes. Well, certainly. Well, thank you very much, Ambassador Lures, to you, to Wendy. It's great to hear you. As you say, Cuba has been responsible for many of the things that have happened in Venezuela. They have been the mentors of Chavez and now Maduro. And I do believe that they can be very constructive. I do believe that knowing that with the Biden administration, there is a possibility of rethinking about what was the Obama approach to Cuba. What I would ask the Biden administration on this issue is, if that is going to happen, as I understand it has been said throughout the campaign, that should happen conditioning the contribution of Cuba to the democratization of Venezuela. And as you say, this might be very hard, but I think it's absolutely necessary to understand that Maduro is way beyond the danger of Cuba. Maduro is a criminal. Maduro has been identified as somebody who's responsible for crimes against humanity and for violations of human rights by the UN, by the Alta Comisionada Michelle Bachelet, who was a Chilean president representing the socialist government. And she has made a very precise presentation of how human rights violations are happening in Venezuela. Also, the ICC, the International Criminal Court, has concluded that there are enough elements to identify the criminal responsibility of Maduro. So what I'm saying with this is that there needs to be a clear difference between whatever is going to be the Cuba policy of the Biden administration and what needs to be the policy towards Venezuela, that it needs to have very clear that regime change is necessary, and that regime change needs to happen in order to open the possibility of free and fair elections, and that the human tragedy that is happening in Venezuela, that is affecting the entire region, it's affecting all countries of the South American continent. It's only going to heal if there is political change. I am very worried that some people might promote the idea that this is not the time for pushing for regime change, but it's a time of doing policy around the humanitarian issues. And I wanna be very clear about this. I believe that we can do a lot in terms of helping the humanitarian crisis in Venezuela. But the best way and the most direct and timely way to really address a humanitarian tragedy in Venezuela is to bring about political change. Because the source of a problem in Venezuela, as it's very well portrayed in the documentary, is political. It's not a war, it's not a climate tragedy, it's political. So the only way to bring about well-being for the Venezuelan people is to bring about political change. So, I was very long in my answer, but I believe that there is no way in which the policy in Venezuela, or not in no way, we would not like to see a change in the policy that does not address regime change in Venezuela.
Thank you. Next question.
We'll take the next question from Paul Angelo.
Yes, hi. Thank you to everyone on the panel for participating today. And my name is Paul Angelo. I'm a fellow for Latin America Studies at the Council on Foreign Relations, and I'm the author of the Council's recent special report on Venezuela called The Day After in Venezuela, Delivering Security and Dispensing Justice. And I would just like to thank Rebecca Bel Chavez for serving as the chair of my advisory committee for that effort. In any case, I would like to sort of pivot the conversation a bit to the question of humanitarian access to Venezuela. Right now, the international community is relying on some level of international organizations like the Pan American Health Organization, existing civil society and the private sector, whatever's left of the private sector in Venezuela, to distribute humanitarian assistance on the ground. So I guess my question would be for the producers of the film, if they have any sort of indication on what Venezuela's civil society and private sector look like today and at the end of 2020, and perhaps for Leopoldo, what incentives could the United States and its allies offer to Maduro in order to expand the humanitarian foothold in the country, perhaps allowing the entry of the World Food Program into Venezuela? Thank you.
Trying to answer the question as to what it looks like right down on the ground right now. There's two answers to that. There's the one, which is that's a very hard thing to tell, right, as to what it looks like, at least from a perspective of someone who's not as deeply tied to what's going down on the ground and probably doesn't have the proximity to it like Leopoldo or certain other individuals. But I will tell you that based off of sort of our relationship with Federica Davila, who was part of the Green Cross, who was in the documentary, and the experience that she's had with several other NGOs and their networks, it's very unofficial. And a lot of what the distribution looks like is A, trying to find ways to get supplies and things that to areas that need help under the radar, so to speak, because even though that the government has allowed a certain amount of official help to come in, they're oftentimes using their control over those resources as a method to continue their power. And so that ultimately is not serving the ultimate goal of a lot of international help, which is to get the help to everyone who needs it and not just to be a tool in Maduro's sort of war chest of control. And I think that, you know, recently there was an article about how they're taking issue supplies from an NGO that was working toward getting food and things toward children and using their domination over that to basically, again, control the food supply and then continue to control the populace as a result. So I think that's a very unofficial, very difficult process on the ground right now that's trying to use all the unofficial ways to get help in, because the official ways, unfortunately, run the risk of just being co-opted by the regime.
Did you want to
add very briefly? You asked first about the situation of civil society and humanitarian organizations in Venezuela. And I can tell the situation is every day is harder. The regime is going after NGOs. They have imprisoned leaders of NGOs, different NGOs over the last months. And they have seized their equipment. And they have made it very clear that they will criminalize any activity on the humanitarian area that it's not coordinated or subordinated to the dictatorship. However, having said this, there still is civil society doing a lot of things. The church and many NGOs are doing what they can, adapting themselves to the new circumstances, but there is absolutely no match between the capacity of NGOs and the level of this crisis. There's absolutely no match. I mean, there's a lot of great things being done, but it's never enough, not even close to the type of tragedy that needs to be addressed in Venezuela. And as for your question of the humanitarian issue, what ways and what policies should guide the humanitarian approach to Venezuela, I should start by saying what I believe should not be done. I believe that there should not be any flexibilization for Maduro to have capacities of controlling the resources of Venezuela, because experience have shown over and over that he will not use those resources for the benefit of the Venezuelan people. There's only one industry, and it's very well portrayed in this movie, very well portrayed, that it's keeping the dictatorship and in their position, and that the regime is willing to invest everything that they have in this industry. And that's the industry of repression. That industry works in Venezuela. The industry of espionage, of repression, of going against those who are critical to the regime works very well, with international support, with technology, with financial resources. And that's what we are facing. And giving Maduro resources will be giving and channeling resources to that industry of repression and of espionage against the democratic society in Venezuela.
Can I just add one point to this? And that's when it, I think that, Paul, your question is excellent, because the provision of essential supplies into Venezuela, it should be a priority to mitigate the humanitarian crisis. But one of the things that we've learned, not just in Venezuela, but in other situations, is that it's really important that we don't politicize the delivery of humanitarian assistance. Humanitarian aid is most effective when it adheres to principles of neutrality, of impartiality, and independence.
Yes, I can tell you that I believe that, having said what should not be done, I believe that what needs to be done in terms of addressing the humanitarian needs is to work with international agencies. And we have done much of that. We've worked with OPS, we've worked with UNICEF and other UN organizations. We would like to see a much important presence of the World Food Organization, the World Food Program in Venezuela. They have a lot of capacity, and unfortunately they've been blocked in Venezuela, but we believe that they could have a stronger presence. And those are the ways we believe should be the channel for the US, Europe, and the region to channel the humanitarian support to Venezuela through international organizations. And I know that there are sometimes criticism because of their bureaucracy, their costs, and maybe their ways. But it's much better to work with these international organizations than to give resources to Maduro, which we know will not go to the people and will go against the people.
Next question.
We'll take the next question from Alex Farman-Farmian.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Max. Thank you, Nelson, for the great movie. Thank you, Leopoldo, for going to La Calle and fighting for all of us, and Rebecca and Marsha for hosting today. I have a question regarding the Alex Farman-Farmian from Edgewood Management. I have a question. In the past, the opposition has always boycotted elections. That has had limited impact. Could a surprise mass turnout at a vote one day show that a lot of people, the overwhelming majority of people, want a change. It would be very tough to hide maybe those election results. Could that be something, an option? Clearly, you've discussed it. But so what would be the thinking about not continually boycotting, but at one point saying, everybody, a la calle, everyone go vote, and seeing if you can actually legitimize a victory for the opposition?
We've done that. We've done that several times. We actually did it overwhelmingly in 2015, and we won 2/3 of the National Assembly. However, the regime has made it impossible to go to an election and to present results that are different than the will of Maduro. Maduro today and his electoral system is at the level of Saddam Hussein's electoral system, or at the level of Fidel Castro's electoral system. So if he wants to have 75%, that's a decision that he makes and he communicates. And I understand what you are saying about triggering the participation of the people with elections. And that's exactly what we want. That's exactly what we fight for. That's what we are saying should be the one objective that unites the democratic sectors in Venezuela and our international coalition. One single, simple objective: having free and fair elections in Venezuela. And in order to do that, we need to mobilize the Venezuelan people and the international community. But over the last elections, that are not elections, are fraudulent processes that Maduro has put together, it's impossible to participate. Just let me give you an example. If we wanted to participate, we don't have a party, because our parties were expropriated. Maduro decided that we are no longer the legitimate authorities of the democratic parties. So he gave the authorities and the symbols and the colors and the propaganda that is being shown on TV with imposters, with people who are not legitimate leaders of the parties, but they're using our symbols and we cannot participate. More than 35 deputies that were elected, that are leaders, important leaders of different regions in Venezuela, are now under criminal investigation, and many of them are in exile. They cannot participate. And the electoral system that we had, and we were able to oversee and an audit that led us to the victory of 2015, the machines were burned in March of this year. 100,000 machines simply went on fire. No explanations, no investigations, nothing was ever said about that. Why? Because they needed to substitute those machines that we knew more or less worked with machines that were a black box. And today the electoral system in Venezuela is a black box. And on top of that, you have the social control that Max was talking about, the use of food, and now the use of the pandemic in order to have a very profound social control system that really makes it difficult for the people to freely elect.
If I could just add one point to what Leopoldo was saying, which was when we were down there, when we were capturing, there are several elections, the Constituent Assembly election, but also the referendum leading up to that, where all these opportunities to show the popular will was put out there. And in addition to all the things that Leopoldo is talking about, it's really important to understand that given the level of the crisis of what's going on in Venezuela, people's entire lives, days, complete, and we saw this in the case of Randall, revolve around getting food and being able to get food, right? And even if you look at in America, where the fact that we vote on a work day causes several issues for participation on our end. Imagine where you live in an economy where not only is it during a work day or not during a work day, but it's in a situation where basic survival is at question. You know, you're obviously going to have much bigger issues with participation. And then you'll find yourself in a particular case that I can speak to based on our recording was you show up to your place where you're supposed to vote, whatever the address may be. And then you get there and you find out actually your district was reassigned across town to another voting place. And all the people that were supposed to vote in this one area and you thought you had to vote here is actually an hour away because public transportation is a mess in Caracas. So when you look at those types of barriers, it's in addition to everything that Leopoldo says, that type of, although that sounds like a very promising thing, and obviously there's a lot of people who would vote for a candidate again that wouldn't be of the FSU, you know, it's just, there's just too many limitations.
I think we have time for one more quick question.
We'll take the last question from Patrick Dennis Duddy.
Thank you very much. Leopoldo, it's very good to see you again. Your journey has been just extraordinary, and the courage and the dedication you've shown has really been something exceptional. I have one question for you and one for Max and Nelson. For you, what if you could choose, what is the single first step you would like to see from a new U.S. administration, a step to put, if you will, you know, a process into play again, and to break the current stalemate? And for Max and Nelson, what are your plans to make this extraordinary film of yours more widely available? Thank you both. It's very good.
Well, I thank you very much. Thank you, Patrick. I think the most immediate step that needs to happen is to continue to recognize the legitimate leadership of the National Assembly of Juan Guaido in order to maintain unity in Venezuela and the unity of our international coalition. Guaido today is the representative that is being recognized by almost 60 countries in the world. Because of the National Assembly, of course. And that is something that we cannot put at jeopardy. We need to maintain our internal coalition and our international coalition towards a common and very concrete goal, as I've said several times today, which is free and fair elections. And then after that, it's discussing tactics. It's discussing what to do with sanctions, what to do, how to create pressure, what are the incentives that need to be created. And having clarity of who and the type of system that we are facing that is a criminal system. But unity, maintaining unity is essential. And in order to do that, there needs to happen the clear recognition of the National Assembly after this turbulence of the fake elections that Maduro is putting together that are happening next week. And that the recognition will need to happen starting January of next year.
Thank you so much. It's 5 o'clock, so I'm going to have to end the meeting. Thank you so much for joining today's virtual meeting. And thank you so much to Rebecca Bill Chavez, Leopoldo Lopez, Nelson Gonzalez Navarrete, and Max Caicedo. Thank you so much. It's been an honor.
Muchísimas gracias a todos. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Gracias.